We're delighted to welcome Cecile Lipworth, who is the founder of the Ripple Catalyst Studio and native to South Africa and a longtime resident here in Santa Fe. She is one of the folks who was instrumental in getting some of the V-Day events unwrapped and promoted across the country and around the world. And in fact, we danced with her at V-Day a couple of years ago at the flash mob down at the State House, and I think we taught all of you Break the Chain, which is the flash mob dance in church on a Sunday morning. So welcome back. We also have Bernice Steinhardt, the president of Art and Remembrance, which is an arts and educational organization. Well, we're going to hear a lot about it. It's to tell a particular very moving story about the images that you saw on the screen up front during the prelude. Bernice is the co-author of a book called Memories of Survival and the executive producer of an award-winning film called Through the Eye of a Needle, The Art of Esther Niesenthal Krinitz. I think it was Muriel Rukeyser who said that the world is made of stories. And I'm not entirely sure about the world, but I certainly know that people are made of stories. We're made of the stories that we tell ourselves about the kind of people we are. We're made of the stories we tell ourselves about our past and our ancestors and the kind of people they were. We're made of the stories we tell ourselves and each other about the future and what it could be and what we think we deserve and what we are called to do to make the future that we dream of into a reality. One of our strengths as a community is that when we come together, we are able to share our stories. We can even tell the same story from many different perspectives in order to get a better understanding of what really happened and who was there and what the causes were. This morning, we're going to talk about two stories which intersect and overlap in some interesting ways. There are two stories about World War II and the rise of Hitler and the Holocaust. One story is the memory of a Jewish girl who survived the occupation of Poland and emigrated to America and told her story to her daughters in the beautifully embroidered fabric panels that you saw during the prelude. The other story is the documentary that Ken Burns has made about two Unitarians, Martha and Waitstill Sharp, a minister and his wife who were sent to Czechoslovakia to help Jews, intellectuals, and children escape, and whose adventures will, I think, invite you to reappraise your take on what it means to be a Unitarian Universalist. These are two stories about a difficult time, two stories of ordinary people, two stories of how they met extraordinary circumstances with courage and with creativity. We have two guests with us this morning, Cecile and Bernice. They are instrumental in bringing the first story to Santa Fe. And I'm going to start with Bernice and ask if you will tell us, and Cecile, please chime in whenever it feels appropriate. Tell us about the story you're sharing and why it's important not just to you but to Santa Fe and the rest of the country.
My mother grew up in a little tiny village in the center of Poland, and she was 12 years old in 1939 when the Germans invaded Poland and they came straight to her village and occupied her village for 3 years until October 1942. So we're coming up against the anniversary of the deportation of the Jews of her village and the surrounding area. They were all ordered to report to a nearby train station. My mother refused to go. She was 15 at the time, and she took her 13-year-old sister, and the two of them said goodbye to their family, and they never saw them again. So unlike many other Holocaust survivors, maybe most other Holocaust survivors, my mother always told us. She always talked about her experiences, and my sister and I grew up hearing her stories all the time. Not just the war stories, but about her childhood in this little village, and they were entrancing stories. They were filled with adventure and magic and mystery and danger. But when my mother was about 50, so after my sister and I were all grown up, my mother decided that she really wanted my sister and me to see what her home and her family looked like. She had never been trained as an artist. She didn't know how to draw, but she could sew anything. She was a very gifted seamstress. She'd actually been apprenticed to a dressmaker when she was 8 years old. So she took a piece of fabric, and she a large piece of fabric, and she sketched out her house and her family, and she filled it all in with stitches. And it was very satisfying to her because it reflected what was in her mind's eye. And she gave that to me, and she made a companion piece for my sister, and then sort of set those aside and was busy with many other things. And then about 10 years later, so she was in her early 60s, she went back to these memory pictures, and she started creating these scenes of her leave-taking from her family and the exodus of the Jews on their way to the train station. And she started adding stitched narrative captions. And once she started telling her story in this way, she never stopped until actually she grew too sick to work any further. And by the time she died, she had completed 36 altogether of these memory pictures. And they're exquisite, they're beautiful, they're colorful. Even though she's telling a difficult and sometimes very painful story, she never lost the beauty and forgot the beauty of the world in which she lived. And those images are now on display at the Community Gallery of the Convention Center. But they stand not only as a story in and of themselves, they also stand as an inspiration for other people in the community to tell their stories in the form of story cloths and textiles. And we've been doing workshops with people who have immigrated to the United States and live in Santa Fe and tell and are telling in their story cloths about their lives, the lives they left behind, their journeys, and their hopes and dreams of their life in the United States.
One of the things I noticed when I went to the opening and looked at the art, it is so beautiful. You look at it, and they are these joyful, colorful images, and they seduce you almost by their texture and their color and their playfulness into looking much more closely. And it's only then that the narrative sort of hooks you and the blood drains from your face and you realize what's happening in that image is something that would be terrifying if it was happening to you. And so there's a way in which it pulls you into staying present to something that if you knew what you were getting into, you might turn away.
I think that I grew up in South Africa and I went to a Jewish day school for 12 years of my life. I'm Jewish. And the pictures I was shown growing up were all the black and white horror photos of survivors in the Nazi camps. And when I saw Bernice's, Esther's artwork, I think the thing that sort of grabbed me was exactly that, the power that art has to not just, because when you see the black and white pictures, you kind of look away. You don't want to see what those pictures are depicting. But the beauty of Esther's artwork is that you do want to look deeper into it, and you do then start saying, oh, I get what was going on. While all this trees are blooming, flowers are blooming, fruit on the trees, the rivers are flowing, there's this horror going on. in our everyday lives. And I think that's something that even today we have to think about and take account of. What, while we all live this gorgeous life in Santa Fe and we celebrate the beautiful fall that's happening right now and the abundance on our trees, what is the other side of the story that happens in Santa Fe, especially right now?
So that's one story, and that's one way of telling a story, is and helping us listen by using more senses than just our ears and inviting us to bring our imaginations and our memories into engagement with what we see in front of us. A second way of telling the story of what happened in that time is what we will see in the Sharps War documentary. And one of the things I notice is, like Esther's family, the Sharps were pretty ordinary people going about their own lives when history sort of arrived on their doorstep. Now, for Esther's family, history arrived in the form of an army. For the Sharps, history arrived with a phone call on a Sunday evening after church and a confirmation class and visiting people who were homebound. It was snowy. Wade Still and Martha were sitting in their study and the phone rang, and it was the president of the UUA, who was also a member of Wade Still's congregation, and he said, "Come and have coffee." This didn't happen on a Sunday night, so Wade Still and Martha called a babysitter and got their kids settled and went over and had coffee. And the invitation that they were offered was an invitation to please go to Czechoslovakia, take these resources and this money with you, and meet with our friends who are there, and ostensibly be on tour with our congregations in that part of the world, but really and truly begin delivering humanitarian aid and getting people out. And Wade Still said, "How many other people have you asked?" And the answer was 17. 17 other clergy couples were approached and were not able to find the courage to say yes. And Wade Still and Martha said yes immediately. They didn't just go once. They went multiple times. They helped at least 125 people escape. They are among the five Americans recognized by Israel as righteous among the nations. Not just because they helped, lots of people helped, but because they actually went into danger in order to help, rather than waiting for the danger to arrive on their doorsteps. One of the things that I think is interesting about them is they never talked about it afterwards. The only reason we actually know about their adventures and their story is that their grandson, Artemis Jawowski, had an assignment given when he was a sophomore or a freshman, had an assignment given to him to write a paper about moral courage. And he casually mentioned this to his mother, and his mother said, "Well, you know, you might want to talk to your grandparents." And he said, mummy and Grandpa Sharp?" She said, "Yeah, they did something important during World War II." And he couldn't imagine his mild-mannered grandparents, who never even talked to him about World War II, had anything to do with it. But in the process of interviewing them and writing the paper, he got hooked. And that is how we have the story. He also says it's the only A he ever got on a paper. And the first version was only 8 pages long, the one that he turned in for the assignment. So, for him, he had to, the author, the grandson, had to reimagine who he was in light of this new story of who his grandparents were, and he felt it was significantly important for us as Unitarian Universalists to hear that story and maybe begin to reimagine who we are. One of the things that happens when you understand yourself as descended from heroes is that you look at the way you encounter the world in a different way. And you look at what's unfolding around you and you say, what am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do? What's happening in our world now has uncanny similarities to what was happening in the late 1930s and the 1940s in Germany and Eastern Europe. What are we called to do now? Now, the Story Clause Project is one answer to a way we can respond. Do you want to tell us a little more about that particular project and what's happening this week?
I just want to say, in response to the story you just told about the Sharps, and perhaps indirectly to answer the very last question that you asked of me, my mother told her story because she wanted, and depicted her story, because she wanted my sister and me to know what her life had been like, and in particular to know about the family that she had loved and lost. It was a way of passing on her memories to her family. But of course, once we saw what my mother, our mother, had done, then it became urgent to share her art and her story with the rest of the world. What she created was really more than just a family legacy. It was really meant to be seen out into the world. At the end of the documentary film that we made about our my mother, called Through the Eye of the Needle, we have a quote from Elie Wiesel that says, "Whoever reads or listens to a witness becomes a witness." And I think it relates to all that we're talking about this morning. The responsibility, it was personally a truth for me, but it is, I think, a truth for us as human beings and certainly as a community, that when we become aware of what happens in the world, especially the experience of war and injustice in any form that it takes, then it is our responsibility to speak that truth, to pass on the words, the images, the experiences that are given to us, to pass that on to others, to our children, and to the rest of the world. And that's what we are doing with our Storycloth project as well. We're sharing my mother's legacy and using it as a form of inspiration to create and share these other stories that are part of our lives, part of our community, and to bring them into that fold of common humanity.
So if I can just give you some context, I don't actually think we explained what the project was right up front. So Bernice and I met a couple of years ago, and I was really inspired by her mother's work. And one of the sort of prominent pieces of her tapestry is an image of her coming to the United States with the Statue of Liberty. And Bernice was a baby in her arms, and they're looking at the Statue of Liberty. And Bernice and her sister, through their organization, Art and Remembrance, had already begun to do workshops with immigrants who are current immigrants to the United States. And we started talking, and Santa Fe is such a rich city of immigrants dating thousands of years back. But really, what is the current story of our immigrants in this town? And I'm an immigrant, as I said earlier, and I'm a very privileged immigrant. My immigration was incredibly privileged. I won my green card in the lottery. I'm white. My accent is always seen as very charming when people meet me, but it's not the case for all the immigrants in our town. And many times if immigrants have brown skin or they speak with a different accent, we don't view that as charming. And so when we began to talk, we really saw the integration of Bernice's mother's work as an inspiration to do workshops here in Santa Fe with immigrants here. And for us as a community to start to listen and to hear, and I loved what you read at the beginning of the service, the opening words. It's exactly what we're trying to accomplish with this exhibit, with stitching our stories. People are not just stitching their stories, but we're stitching our stories as a community of how we integrate and how we listen to immigrants, how we view immigrants when we see them as our neighbors and in the stores with us and cleaning our homes and everything they do for us. And so that was a really important piece of what I and Bernice wanted to bring to this community. And so on Wednesday evening, we are inviting the community to come and be in conversation. It's not panel discussions, it's literally one-on-one conversations where you get to talk to immigrants, whether their stories are ones of leaving countries because of violence or because they have great immigration stories like myself. We still have a huge commonality of the things, just like Esther, of leaving our families behind, of remembering our homes, our gardens, the smells, the sights of where we came from. And that's been a really humbling experience for me, just doing this project, understanding my own grief of leaving my family. My parents still live in South Africa, my sister, my friends. And just giving me that context just on my own and being able to listen to other women and men in this community. So that's the bigger context of this exhibit.
And it takes us beautifully to an opportunity that is going to present itself very, very soon. Last spring, last winter, when the troubles in Syria sort of escalated, a number of you asked me, what can we do for Syrian refugees here in Santa Fe? And I said, well, I don't know, but we'll find out. The ILA, the Interfaith Leadership Alliance, and a group called Welcoming Santa Fe were already in the process of petitioning the government for Santa Fe to become a refugee resettlement site. This in spite of the fact that our governor was not happy about the notion of welcoming Syrian refugees. And so because of that, it took much longer than it might have. We received approval to be a refugee resettlement site this past week. So Santa Fe is now officially a refugee resettlement site. When the mayor talked to the president of the ILA, he said he had received a call from the White House and that it was a go, and that since Santa Fe didn't have the infrastructure in place to do all of this by itself, they would be relying very heavily on the congregations of the Interfaith Leadership Alliance, which is us. We are one of the founding congregations. Monies are to be released on October 1st. The Lutheran Immigration and Refugee Resettlement Organization that handles refugee resettlement in this part of the country and is based in Albuquerque is going to open an office here in Santa Fe, and we will keep you posted about the kinds of practical and social support that we can provide to our neighbors as they move into our community. At this point, the United States has already settled the quota it was willing to accept of Syrian refugees. But I assure you that whoever arrives in Santa Fe to be our neighbors is also going to be in dire need. They are also going to be people whose stories will probably give us goosebumps and break our hearts. And so I encourage you and invite you, as a beginning of a journey we are taking together, to watch Sharp Sword, the documentary, and join us for the conversations that will follow, to go down to the community gallery on Wednesday and listen to the people who are already here. In some ways, we're thinking of this as something new, but it isn't. But it isn't. We have a strong Korean refugee community. There's a thriving Tibetan Buddhist refugee community. We have people from all over the world already here. We know how to practice hospitality and how to do this. We just need to get out those skills and polish them up a little bit and open our hearts and step forward.
And listen and speak.
And listen and listen and listen.
It's about sharing stories and getting to know one another. And that's how we become neighbors, by breaking down that fear, the indifference, and listening and speaking.
The crisis in New Mexico has been going on for a long time, and there are many women and children in prisons that they actually moved out of New Mexico to Dilley, Texas, who are fleeing violence in South and Central America, who are being imprisoned and deported back to these countries. So, and that's been going on for years here, and there's a lot of people who are trying to stand up for those women and children and try to release them. There's incredible lawyers working. So there's so many different ways we as a community can get involved, and not just sort of on the hot, new, trendy topic of the Syrian refugees, who of course we want to welcome as well. But there are and have been a crisis in our state for a long time that is really important for us to acknowledge as well.
I just want to add that this week is National Welcoming Week, and there are events in communities, grassroots events in communities all over the United States to recognize and to affirm that value that is so intrinsically American of being a welcoming country. And Wednesday, the day of our community conversation, which begins at 5:30, by the way, Wednesday is World Peace Day. And what better way to recognize that than to be good neighbors?
So there are many kinds of heroes. Some get the headlines. Some do dramatic things. Some are quiet, ordinary folks who step up and help when help is needed. Some were brave a long time ago. Some have yet to act. And some are sitting in this room right now. It matters, the stories we tell. It matters the stories we share. It matters that we open our hearts and minds and imaginations as we listen. It matters that we let ourselves be changed and that we find a way to respond. Amen. Shalom. Namaste. Blessed be. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.